Okay, good evening, everybody. Welcome. Today is Monday, July 18th. It is 7:15 p.m. We have a regularly scheduled meeting set to take place at 7. I see we have a lot of friends and neighbors in the house tonight here to speak on a variety of issues. So we're going to have the public speak out portion of our meeting at this time. Our first speaker is Ms. Betsy Johnson regarding the Six Corners redesign. Good evening.
Yeah.
Ms. Johnson, if you could please provide your name and address and do your best to keep your comments to 2 minutes, please.
Yes. Betsy Johnson. I live at 31 Mattoon Street in Springfield. And I'm part of a group called Walk Bike Springfield. We're a group of residents who have been meeting for over a year to help improve bicycling and pedestrian safety throughout the city. We've been working closely with the Department of Public Works and the Health Department and the Planning Department. A number of you were heard from us about the Complete Streets plan that got passed. And one of the things that's been happening as a result of that, we've been very actively looking at the different projects that the Department of Public Works is bringing forth to improve various intersections and streets to see if they're in compliance and with this Complete Streets policy and how they really can move forward, particularly pedestrian safety. And that really is the key with this intersection, which, as I'm sure all of you know, is a very complex intersection with multiple streets coming in and an awful lot of roadways for a pedestrian to have to cross in a lot of little different segments. And what is being proposed is what's called a roundabout. This is not your typical West Springfield rotary. This is a much smaller diameter circle. It really brings the cars down to zero to 15 miles an hour. That is a level that crashes with pedestrians, do not kill them, and in fact is considered state of the art for what to do to improve pedestrian safety in this kind of intersection. So you're going to be presented with approving what's called a Mass Works infrastructure grant for over nearly $2.75 million that the city is poised to receive with no match to do this work at this intersection. Others from the department will, and I know in your packet, there was quite a bit of information about the number of meetings and the process that got the Public Works to this point and got the state to approve, from their end, to approve this grant for Springfield. So I do hope you'll approve it.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Jesse Letterman regarding Herrena School. Good evening, Mr. Letterman.
Good evening, counselors. Jesse Letterman, 147 Westminster Street. I'm one of the coordinators with the Springfield Climate Justice Coalition. I'm joined by our newest and second coordinator, Lisa Torres. We're asked to come down to speak in favor of the resolution for the Herrena School in regards to the funding that the governor needs to release. Obviously, for all of you, this is a no-brainer. Counselors have been very supportive of the issues and the neighborhood concerns around the Herrena School. And nobody knows better than the gentlemen and ladies up here that we need to stand up for ourselves in the city of Springfield. The conditions that Herrena has dealt with for the last several decades are conditions that wouldn't be accepted in suburban school districts. They aren't conditions that would be accepted in the suburbs that border the city of Springfield. And so it's extremely important for our elected officials and our residents to stand up and make strong statements such as this and support these issues so that our children can have healthy, safe learning environments. So we're urging all the counselors to support this resolution and to go further, to call the governor, to speak with the governor's office, the executive branch, and find out how we can make sure that these funds get down to the city of Springfield so that we can make this a safer learning environment for our students. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Maria Perez. Good evening.
Good evening, dear council members. My name is Maria Perez. and I live at 110 Prospect Street in the north end of Springfield. I'm also the president of Women on the Vanguard, Inc., and for many years, Women on the Vanguard have worked to bring attention to the Herrera Community School issue. The worsening condition of the underneath tunnel is a health hazard to all. We do not see the Herrera issue exclusively a North End problem. It is a citywide problem. The students who attend the Herrera Community School are residents of many areas of the city. Herrera's position as a magnet in Montessori School attracts children from all over. Many of the members of Women on the Vanguard live in other areas, and parents of these children approach them on this issue constantly. The Herrera Community School plays a key role in our community. Our elderly, the children, and others use the tunnel because it's the connector of Brightwood and Memorial Square. Shame on all of us to have this issue swept under the carpet for so many years. The most defenseless sector of the city is being affected, the children, our elderly, and we have stood by it and let it happen. Our mayor has tried to bring the school up to par, but as long as the outer infrastructure is not repaired, it is a pointless effort. As member, the city council, you represent the members of these parents, these children, and they look for you for a solution. Women on the Vanguard Inc., Neighbor to Neighbor, the North End Community Corporation, and Union Citizen Council, therefore, respectfully urge you vote in favor of the resolution, encouraging Governor Charles D. Baker to release the $3 million bond monies approved by the legislature in 2014. It is critical that something is in need to be done, not just for the North End, but for our city. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay, our next speaker is Daisy Hernandez. I believe that's what it says. Good evening.
My name is Daisy Hernandez. I live at 58 Johnson Street, but I grew up in the North End. As we all know, Herrera was built for multi-purpose use. Since the floodings began, the first thing condemned were the community spaces, which are condemned till this day. Our community's children walk through the condemned areas on a regular basis to get to school or to cross over to the Plainfield side. I ask you to vote yes to this resolution for the sake of our community members, our elderly, but most importantly, our youth and our children. For it is our responsibility to cultivate a healthy living environment for children, giving them a chance to grow and be successful, and give our community back their community space where they can implement programs that can help them progress with the changing times. After learning what the school's conditions are and the health risks it possesses, would you feel comfortable allowing your family to utilize a space like this? You have all been elected by your constituents to represent your wards, and if you won't allow a school like this in your ward, vote yes for the resolution as if the resolution was for a school in your community. I beg you to vote yes in solidarity with our community and support us in our efforts to make the Herrera issues a priority for our community, which is in dire need. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, our next speaker is Bob McCarroll regarding Community Preservation Act. Good evening, Bob.
Good evening. I'm Bob McCarroll, 96 Elliott Street, and I am on the Ad Hoc Study Committee for Community Preservation Act, and I will be staying through to when you actually deliberate that item number 19 in case you have technical questions. But basically what I wanted to say is CPA is a statewide program that 161 communities have already adopted. It enables communities to put a slight surcharge on their property taxes, and that money goes into a pot that can only be used for open space, recreational space, historic resources, and community housing. The state augments what is raised locally, and the state fees come from registry deed filings and municipal lien filings fees, from all over the Commonwealth. So Springfield, through its property transfers, has already been paying into this fund, but the fund is only distributed to participating communities. The CPA committee has made a recommendation of a, we think, very modest proposal to exempt the first 100,000 of residential, commercial, and industrial value and to impose a 1.5% surcharge. As we've heard at some of one of our public meetings, we've heard people say, well, they don't want to have to pay anymore, or they don't want to pay it for those items that are eligible, or that the city needs to figure out how it can find that money through grants to do that anyway, which are all valid reasons to take into consideration as one goes to the polls on November the 8th. But it's not a valid reason not to pass this on so that the voters of Springfield can determine whether they want to adopt CPA as 161 other communities already have. So I urge you to vote to put it on the ballot so the voters can decide. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Robert Germain regarding handicap parking. Good evening, Mr. Germain.
My name is Robert Germain, 43.5 Armory Street, Springfield. My complaint is around the courthouse, if there's very few handicap parking spaces. Well, I see a lot of them that says tollway zone. Why don't they make the tollway zone into handicap so we have places to park? I got a $50 ticket because the front end of my vehicle was in the tollway zone. $50 to a senior citizen is a lot of money when you're on Social Security. That's all I have to say. But I think there should be something done about those tollway zones. I think it's a rip-off to get money out of the citizens.
Thank you very much, Mr. Germain. Our next speaker is Jafet Robles.
Hello, good evening. How's it going?
Good evening.
My name is Jafet Robles. I live in 43 Chapin Terrace. And I'm here with the North End Coalition. I'm also an organizer for Neighbor to Neighbor. And this coalition, we're a group of concerned citizens who recently joined forces and formed a coalition to call on city and state officials to demand a healthy, environmentally safe, and welcoming educational community center that is vibrant, open to residents year-round and after school hours. I just want to briefly thank the coalition and everybody who's been participating in this HIRANA issue, because it's all residents from the community who have been devoting a lot of their time, a lot of them work. So from the heart, sincerely, I want to thank you guys for your commitment to this issue. Real quick, how many people here on the console have actually been to the HIRANA school and seen the conditions and walked through it? Has everybody been to the HIRANA school recently? Okay, so I just got a quick question. If I owned a business here in the city of Springfield, you know, and my business had, say, like black mold, puddles on the floor, the floors were completely ripped, would my license be taken? Would it be provoked? Or say if I lived, HIRANA in 1999, it was a hurricane that flooded it. And that's when we lost the community spaces. We haven't got them back. If the HIRANA was, say, in East Forest Park, and any East Forest Park, 16 acres, if it was in that area, do you think 20 years later we would still be walking through the same school and still have mold and still have puddles on the wall? Or just to be clear, would these conditions of, you know, mold and puddle be in, say, a Long Meadow or Wilbraham? Would that be allowed? Let's be honest. And like they say in my community, let's keep it real. So I just want to say, my family came here from Puerto Rico. Just like a lot of people come from Puerto Rico here, wanting, you know, the land of opportunity, seeking a better life, better education. Now with the conditions in PR, there's going to be many, many more coming down to the North End with the same conditions. And the North End is the poorest district in the entire state. In the entire state, according to the 2010 census tract. I grew up there. I went to Lincoln Elementary School. I went to HIRANA for preschool. I also went to Lincoln. And Lincoln was one of the schools in the community that was really underfunded. Teachers overworked, underpaid. There's no gym in the school. Kids eat in the class. And I was a very hyper kid. And once I was a hyper kid and I got labeled that kid who got in trouble, once something happened, I was always blamed for it. So, you know, detention led to suspension led to expulsion, and the streets took me with open arms. And as a youth, as a kid in my community, I was blessed. I had a strong mom who worked every day, but most of my friends in this community, their mothers were on drugs. A lot of them were dealing with a lot of issues that were sad. I seen a lot of the pain and suffering that they endured in their lives every day. You might have seen us as a kid in a corner with the baggy clothes and said, man, look at these hoodlums. But deep down inside, all of us just wanted a dad to teach us how to play catch. We were unloved, uncared for. So with that being said, a lot of kids in these communities, we join gangs and we get involved in the streets because we want a sense of community. We want to feel like we're a part of something. We don't got that love at home. So it's the same dilemma going on. Here in the North End, the poorest district in the entire state, right where I grew up, we know the myriad of social problems that come with poverty, you know, and we know the impact that environment has on you. So these kids in this community have no community center. Or a safe haven for them to play at and for them to grow and to learn. So they're facing the same dilemma that I went through when I was a kid growing up. As an organizer, I canvass on doors and I run into kids every day. I see these youth every day who look lost. They need they need guidance. Every mom tells me either two things. They either say, hey, there's nothing for my kid to do in this community. There's nothing for these kids to do. They run around. Or they'll say, I don't let my kid out. It's not safe for them to be there. So my point being is, you know, we recently, there was a young girl who was killed in our community. Me and Adam had to attend that funeral. And every time there's a funeral in a community, you know, we go to those funerals. And in my eyes, you know, I'm in the community. I see these youth running around. We had a safe haven where they can learn. There's plenty of people like Armando, like myself, who have turned our lives around. We would love to give back to our community and do a lot of things to the youth, but we don't have that safe haven to be able to do that. So I think it's realistically, being it's the poorest district in the state, it's important for us to invest in this particular community, invest in our youth. When I was young and I first moved to Springfield, I actually moved to the McKnight area. I lived on Quincy Street, and I played ball at Dunbar. That was a place where it was a safe haven. It was a place where I learned how to play ball, and I don't know what would have happened if we didn't have that at that particular point. So with that being said, the North End, it is vital that we have these kids have a safe haven and a place where they could grow. I'm tired of going to funerals with Adam. You know, I'm sick of going to hospital beds. I'm sick of going to all of these things that me personally could be prevented. So with that being said, for all the kids who are out there in the North End, for the kids in the North End who I see struggling, often come from single parent homes and different issues, and for the parents, I want to let you know that we love you. We want to let you know that we care for you, that those conditions that you do matter, and that we're not going to give up. Until you have a safe haven where you can have self-productively, we're not going to let up. So we feel that your zip code should not determine your quality of your education. So with that being said, I just want to close out by saying, you know, if we don't invest in our community, we're going to spend the money later. For every kid that we don't invest in, he's going to either end up locked up. That's going out of your taxes. People who get on welfare, all these different things. If we don't invest in these youth that come from these impoverished areas, we spend more for it in a long time. So if you don't have a heart and you're concerned more about your taxes, let's put it that way. So with that being said, I want to ask you guys to please know that, you know, a kid in the North End has the same value as a kid in East Forest Park, in 16 Acres, or in any other area. So I ask you today to please support us on this issue, and I'm going to end with a quote by MLK that says, in the end, we remember not the words of our enemies, but the silence of our friends. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our next and final speaker is Georgiana Hart, regarding Community Preservation Act. Good evening, Ms. Hart.
Good evening, Mr. Fenton. Georgiana Hart, 13 Wilcox Street. I went to the presentation that the ad hoc committee you appointed did the other night on the Community Preservation Act. I have to tell you, I was impressed, number one, with the work they did, number two, with how nicely constructed the law is. It was nice to see something that nice and boxed and simple that came out of the legislature. There were people there at the meeting, and I will describe it as they were just huffing and puffing. And I would urge everybody to look at this as the simple proposal that it is. It doesn't need a lot of ranting and raving and everything like that. I would like to see it go on the ballot in November, because it is one of those laws where the people who vote in this city get to decide whether or not we will become part of this project. And I would like to see it moved forward simply without all the huffing and puffing. Everybody gets to decide whether or not they want to do it in November. It would be a lovely thing. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Hart. Okay, that's going to conclude our public speak out portion of tonight's meeting. We're going to call our regular meeting to order. Mr. Clerk, if the council and our guests could please take their seats. Mr. Clerk, if you could please call the roll. Councilor Hurst has called me. He's feeling under the weather. He will not be here this evening.
Absent. Councilor Shea.
Present.
Present. Councilor Twiggs.
Present.
Present. Councilor Allen.
Present.
Present. Councilor Rook. Absent.
Present.
Oh, present. Councilor Bud Williams.
Here.
Present. Councilor Ramos.
Present.
Present. Councilor Marcus Williams.
Present.
Present. Councilor Gomez.
Present.
Present. Councilor Ash. Present. Councilor Edwards. Present. Councilor Walsh.
Present.
Councilor Edwards.
Present. Will the council and our guests please rise for a moment of silence? Please remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Councilor Twiggs. Any objection to hearing those two first? Okay, Mr. Clerk, let's call item number five first, please.
Item number five is a grant for the dispatch department, no match in the amount of $663,262.
Okay, good evening, Ms. Nazaro.
Hello, how are you guys tonight and ladies? So I'm here today to ask for the annual support incentive grant that we get every year from the state 911 department. $663,000 and change. It's used to put towards operational expenses. We put the entire thing up towards our actual salaries costs for our dispatchers. It helps to offset our salaries by almost a third each year.
Any questions from the council? All those in favor of receiving the grant, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Okay, item number 11, Mr. Clerk.
Item number 11 is a grant, is a dispatch training grant in the amount of $129,824, sponsored by the mayor.
Ms. Nazaro.
Thank you. This grant is also given to us by the state 911 department on an annual basis. This grant we use to support all of the continuing education and new hire training that we do for our employees. It also is able to be used for some of our testing software and some of the other call processing software that we use. So we spread this out over a couple of different areas within our budget.
Any questions from the council? All those in favor of receiving the grant, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Any more business?
That is all. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Gomez.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'm asking if we can take item number 27 out of order.
Okay. Seeing no objections, Mr. Clerk, item number 27.
Item number 27 is a resolution regarding Herrera School Improvements, sponsored by Adam Gomez.
Councilor Gomez.
Thank you, colleagues, Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen, and the crowd. Thank you for coming in solidarity with this resolution that I'm presenting today. A lot of you know that I'm very, very emotional about the things that I bring forth here in this chamber, and just want to start off how blessed I am to really be able to work with these individuals with the campaign for Fight for Herrera, because this is actually the first time in a long time that a lot of the organizations came together as one and really stood fast with the community, with other organizations, neighborhood board, and with myself, State Representative Carlos Gonzalez, and our Senator James Welch also. The North End Coalition started a couple months ago around the Fight for Herrera, Whims of the Vanguard, Neighbor to Neighbor, which I'm still a member of, the New North Citizens Neighborhood Board, and the North End Community Corporation. A lot of these groups, it first started coming together when it was for the issue that was going on with the Alcohol Treatment Center on Washington Street. A lot of people got involved with what was going on at that time, and some of these residents that never even knew each other ended up even running for our neighborhood board and came out victorious. Carmen Santana, Jenny, Girona, and it just made me start feeling again that this community together can really start doing some things. So after the victory from the Western Mass Coalition, with the Western Mass Alcohol Treatment Center, because it is a big victory for our community, we stood behind and figured out that Herrera has a lot of things that's going on. I went to Herrera from third through eighth grade. I've only been to three schools. I went to Brightwood, and then Herrera, for some reason, they turned into a third through eighth grade school. And at the time when I went to Herrera for the third through eighth grade, it was flooded twice. There was a point in time from sixth and seventh grade I couldn't even attend Herrera because of the damage that was done from a water main break after the hurricane. And I ended up attending the Central Academy at the time in the basement, learning with a good group of people. And people don't understand that Herrera is a school that all kids, it's a magnet school. It's kids that in each of all your wards, they all attend. And we also have a council member that he's not here, but his son attends that school. And this is not just a school that is, it is embedded and it has a lot of kids from the North End that come to it, but there's kids from everywhere in our city that migrate to this great school. This school has embodied and instilled many leaders in this room and has been the center focal point of our community. A long time ago in the 1960s or the 1970s, I don't know exactly when, there was urban planning. And Councilor Williams and I have talked times of that when that was the reason why he moved out of the North End. Big Highway came and kicked families out.
Kicked out of the North End.
Kicked out of the North End. And kicked. You know, the way that they figured that they would attach Memorial Square with Brightwood was through this tunnel. And funny thing is that I had conversations with a bunch of people before I move on, and I even had a conversation with a councilman's brother, which I'm not going to say, but he used to work as a janitor as a kid. His first job was at Herrera, and in the 70s, he said there was mold. And the fact of the matter is now, when we're coming up to this point where we're trying to drive with this resolution, you know, we've been working hard with our fellow people at the on a city level, you know, Chris Signoli, Pat Sullivan, Mayor Sarno, trying to really find a way to figure out what's going on. So inevitably, we figured out, and when we did our research, that there was $3 million put aside. The $3 million came under the Volpatrick, but as everybody knows, through a Chapter 70 bond, it needs to be released and signed by the governor. So right now where we're at with the other also people that collaborated with us, with a lot of, because everybody played a role with where we're at today. And this is part of our process. And the Climate Justice Coalition, they lended a hand on a lot of, you know, investigative materials that, you know, we're not professionals. They have doctors, they have people from everywhere else that wants to get involved, that, you know, wants to see Herrera be repaired. And to educate you guys a little bit, yeah, we don't deal with the principals and the schools and things of that nature, but the city, our city council, deals with the building structures. We might not, and we deal with transportation when it comes to schools. So I know that we've tried over the years, and it's every time we kind of get to a certain point, it kind of lags. But I think right now we're at a point that we want to see this school redone. We want our auditorium back. We want to be able, we have plenty of space. Now the only space that's left, New North Citizen Council uses it for outreach kids, and the the secretary and one of the people that, one of the direct coordinators or directors in that program, they're starting to get rashes on their face. We have medical documentation that shows that even though EPA came by, and I thank Mayor Sarno and Pat Sullivan for coming and having a forum for the community to engage the community with their questions and understand where are we at. And the questions were arose that they wanted to know, is the school fixable? And Pat Sullivan said, yes, this school is fixable. We can get another 40 years out of this school. You know, so where we're at now is we want to make, we understand that Senator Jimmy Welch and State Representative Carlos Gonzalez and myself, that we're aligned with these organizations because they all fall into our district. But this school, even though it's not in your district, some of your constituents' kids go to the school. In closing, I just want you guys to understand the seriousness, because the school itself was separated into three different parts. The A tunnel is considered a bridge. Then the B part, the B structure, is the school, which the B structure looks fabulous. They put they dumped a ton of money in there. The pumps are looking great, but where these community spaces are located are in Tunnel A and Tunnel C. An RFP has went out already. I don't know if it's been picked up by an organization or if they selected a person, but Tunnel C, the RFP went out and they're supposed to repair and fix the floor, because that Tunnel C, it goes actually under the railroad, and Tunnel B goes under the highway. So there's different parts to this. And then everybody knows when you want to look for money for roads or for bridges, realistically, there's no road for bridges. In the state, there's no road for bridges. So that's why you might see some questions on the next ballot about, you know, the fair share tax initiative, and parts of that money taxing millionaires is about finding monies for bridges, because it's not a secret that our infrastructures are collapsing, and we've had that conversation with maintenance and development, and bridges is something that we have to pay attention to in Western Massachusetts also. So in closing, I just I fully support this, not only that I went there, but I know that my community, my constituents, and everybody else would. It's not only our community that use this space. I remember going into this space and seeing the joy of kids and being able to do plays, getting together and seeing musicians come in and utilizing this. I went to camp. I spent my whole life basically in these walls. And with what my brother Jafet and my sister Daisy had stated, and I could say that she's like a mom to me, Maria Perez, is that this is something that our whole community has stood up together. And I also want to commend a colleague of mine that came out to our rally, and that was Budell Williams. He came out with me and he stood with us in solidarity and spoke at this event, because not only is he an at-large counselor, but he understood, because he's from there and he understands the impacts of what our schools are to our community. So in closing, I'm gonna read the resolution, and hopefully at the end of this resolution, you guys see in favor that we just wanna encourage the Governor Charles Baker, that, you know, he's been doing a lot of different things, but this right here, we understand it didn't come under his administration, but his signature is required for our community to move on. And then also, sorry, thank you. I also have a petition to Governor, our Governor of Massachusetts, Charlie Baker, that these individuals went out on their own and they got over 500 signatures. And I wanted to introduce and give them to you, Mr. Clerk, for our council members to understand that not only the people that are here, but we have residents and people around our city that has signed this petition that is going straight to the governor. And this resolution will be attached to this. And we're going to give it to all of our local elected officials and also to the governor's office. So if I can hand this to you, Mr. Clerk. Thank you. Thank you. All right. Resolution requesting that Governor Charlie Baker authorize the release of funds to repair the Herrera School and adjoining tunnel. Whereas all children, particularly those living in social, economically disadvantaged communities, should have a safe and welcoming environment where they can participate in sports, arts, and learning. Whereas the Herrera School serves as the North End's largest elementary school and as tunnel that allows residents access to Main Street and Plainfield Street. Whereas a recent report from the Environmental Protection Agency concluded that years of flooding, fire, and natural aging have caused damage to the school and adjoining tunnel. Whereas the same report found that mold contamination is high throughout the school and that respiratory health is a particular concern since over one-fifth of the student body suffer from asthma. Whereas state bonds that could be used to pay for the repairs in this school have been pending for 4 years. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Springfield City Council, that the council formally requests that Governor Baker authorize the release of $3 million in funds to remove mold and repair the HVAC system in Harena School and repair the tunnel between Main Street and Plainfield Street. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Councilor Ramos?
Thank you, Mr. President. I just want to stand in favor of this resolution. I want to thank my colleague, Councilor Gomez, for bringing this to the forefront. You know, I've been a member of this body for almost 3 years now, and I've voted in favor of several projects across the city. And it's hard to argue against anyone who says that the city of Springfield disproportionately distributes funds towards projects in different communities, because that's not the case. And you know, I want to thank DeFet for his very passionate speak out, and want to briefly answer his question when he asked whether or not this would be tolerated in other neighborhoods, because the simple answer to that question is no. Absolutely. It would not be tolerated in other neighborhoods. Had this been in 16 acres, it would have been addressed years ago. Had this been in East Forest Park, it would have been addressed years ago. But here we are, you know, 20 years later from the point where this should have been addressed, we're still fighting to fix the problem at Harena School. The state legislature has already done their part. Now it sits on Governor Baker's desk, and we're asking for Governor Baker to release the bonds. And I'm thankful to the administration for being willing to bond for those funds, the $3 million, for the much-needed repair of Harena School. And I'm hoping that my colleagues will support this resolution as well, and ask Governor Baker to release the funds. Thank you.
Okay. Councilor Marcus Williams.
Thank you, Mr. President. Very briefly, I just have to also thank Councilor Gomez for helping bring this issue to light, because it's certainly been on the table for a very long time. My brother actually went to Harena, so this is familiar territory for me. He grew up with respiratory issues, and whether going to that school stemmed those problems, it certainly did not help. So I certainly, again, thank everyone, the participating organizations, for being steadfast in your commitment to your community. And I certainly stand in favor of this resolution and hope that Governor Baker hears this message and stands also with us.
Okay, Councilor Walsh.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I plan on supporting this and voting for the resolve. I'd like to say that my children attended the Harena School. At that point in time, it was New North, but I mean, they always talk fondly about Harena School and have lifelong friends that they met there. And one of my children had an opportunity to be part of the enrichment there, and it made a difference in her career choice. So I know how important it is. As you say, students come from all over, so it's a citywide issue. But Mr. President, I think the community support and involvement is very, very impressive. So I plan on supporting it, because I think when you have such a large group of people that come together, you deserve to know that your council is with you. Good luck.
Councilor Ash and Councilor Williams.
Mr. President, I'm happy to rise and support this as well. I was only wondering if there was someone from the city that could address, is the $3 million that the councilor suggested, is that, will that fix what needs to be repaired? I just know that this has been.
No, okay. Just to answer your question, sorry, thank you, Carlos. The $3 million is just to fix the membrane on Bernie Avenue. So the $3 million in communication with Pat and the mayor is that the rest of the money has to come out of city funds to finish this project. This is just to get the ball rolling to make sure that it repairs the leak. So if we don't repair this leak and we throw this money straight into the tunnel, all we're doing is just doing something for the facade. We're not doing nothing for the infrastructure. And a lot of this membrane, it's still leaking, and we need to fix the outside first so then we can get rid of this mold on the inside and then give it a nice face and make sure that it's repaired the right way.
Thank you, Councilor. I felt that kind of was the case. I know, you know, as a member of the school committee going back 20 years, this was an issue then, and it's a very complicated one. But this is, I think, it's a good start. I know we've got some work ahead of us in terms of providing the funds that are necessary to make that happen. So, but thank you for bringing it to the floor.
Councilor Williams?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. President. And thank you, Adam, and the community. And this is it's bittersweet. You know, folks have been, since 2014, fighting a problem that exists that we know any other neighbor in the city of Springfield, this would have been done. Or they have working. I don't know what Governor Baker's up to. I don't know what the issue is, but this goes back a long way. People have always looked at the North End as a second-class community. I grew up on the North End. I kind of get it. That urban renewal, that highway that came through and displaced black and Hispanics and white families, it still has left the mark on the city. That was a thriving community, trust me, really thriving community. And I'm so happy, and good things do come off the North End. Bud Williams came off the North End. Your Congressman Neal came off the North End. Helen Cullen, your health commissioner sitting right there, came off of the North End of Springfield. Henry Payne came off the North End of Springfield. There are great leaders in this city to come off the North End of Springfield. You just gotta fight the fight, man. Just
Jan
gotta Denny, fight the battle.
Right next, Jan Denny.
I'm gonna get to the Rivera family in a minute, if you let me get there. But we know what it is. And certainly I wanna thank the partnership and the togetherness that goes back to when Barbara Rivera and Reverend Wells and Ruth Lovings and Ben Ramos and Ruth Lovings and Barbara Rivera and Mr. Martinez and Herbie and all those folks who came together. You know, Barbara Rivera used to get more done without anybody ever being elected. It amazed me how much got done in the North End before they had an elected, this before Shura was elected, because Sacco was the rep, McKenna was the rep before him. She got stuff done. You know why she got stuff done? See, when you put that fist together like that, when it's open, when that fist is like that, how much power it is, when you come together, that's what happens. That's what happens. I'm very proud to stand here tonight as a member of the North End, and I was down there, that was months ago, and certainly this is, I'm really embarrassed to stand here. It's almost like the community's begging. You get to a point, you have meeting after meeting after meeting, letters and letters and petitions, and the beat goes on, as if no one pays attention. Mr. President, I would suggest we send the letter. I mean, you're on, you got your course, you're with you're doing the legislative process. Governor Baker needs to have this. Does he even know about this? I mean, what? I asked one question. We sent a letter to Governor Baker. What was the response from Governor Baker? I'd be interested to know. Mr. President, I mean, I think Charlie Baker's done a good job on the outset of going. People deserve an answer. Are you going to do it? Is there a timetable you're going to do it? This fiscal year, next fiscal year, 2 years out, we need an answer from the governor. I mean, he represents all of the citizens of the Commonwealth, not just people in Western Mass, east of Western Mass, which is Boston. And I think we need to send a strong letter, Mr. President, with your signature on it, just Mr. Governor, the people have a right to know. Don't make people beg, crawl. We go with you, and if we don't go with you, then we turn around, look at TJ, we look at Pat Sullivan, and we say, we're gonna get this done. One way or the other, I'll never forget when we were doing the Civic Center. They were doing the Civic Center, Mr. President, and the state wouldn't do the Civic Center. The mayor sitting down there at the time, we signed the bond to do the Civic Center. The city signed the bond to do the Civic Center. You embarrassed the state. Katie, you were on the council at the time. Timmy, you were on the council at the time. And you know what happened, Adam? We embarrassed them so bad, they wrote the bond. In other words, sometimes you have to embarrass people. That thing should, $3 million is not a lot of money in a almost a $689 million, billion-dollar budget. So certainly, I stand with the citizens of the North End. We're going to get this done. And I'm telling you, if Pat, TJ, if the state doesn't step foot, we have to find a way to step in the gap to fill the void. Because I'm tired of having these meetings and these rallies and these letters. Sooner or later, someone's got to pay the piper. And as Giuseppe said, you pay me now or pay me later. Because let me tell you, when you don't invest on the front end, they end up incarcerated. About $45,000, $50,000. You can send a kid to Harvard for that nowadays. Maybe you can. I don't know. Probably more than that now. I'm very serious. The front end or the back end? That old commercial, pay me now or pay me later, but you're going to pay. So I hope we get this on the right track. We get some action and action immediately. But again, I want to commend you, Adam, Women of the Vanguard, Maria, all the new groups for at least working together and in the spirit of Barbara Rivera and you know what she meant. She believed in the unity in this community. With unity, you can get stuff done. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor Williams. I'd like to recognize we are joined here tonight by the president of the New North Citizens Council, Norm Roldan. Mr. Roldan, if you wouldn't want to come forward and say a few words. He had previously signed up for public speak out.
Thank you. I apologize for being late. I thank you, the president and councilors, for hearing this bill that Adam put together, along with the neighbor to neighbor, you know, Women of Vanguard, North End Coalition. They work hard on this. And it's a shame that we're here, really, because like Bud said, you know, this has been going on for years. To be standing here and still fighting for this, if nothing happens, look at this, how bad it is. If nothing happens, it's really a shame for us because we had an opportunity right now to approach our governor, let him know how we feel. We always, you know, yell and fight separately. But on this one bill, we're united.
Yes, sir.
We're all together. So if we can't get this done, shame on the governor not letting him do it. And not having us be able to do this early on, we need to make sure that we get it done this time. I don't want to go into details and how it happened, what happened. It happened. It happened. And young leaders like, you know, Jafed and leaders like Maria Perez and Carmen and Jenny and people that are stepping up in the North End are reminding the old leaders that if we don't wake up, we're gonna lose a lot.
Yes, sir.
So starting with me today, we need to unite and fight this bill together. So I ask that everybody signs and support this bill. And let's go back to the State House and say, we need this done.
Yes, sir.
And going back to talking about more money needed, this is just a membrane. We need to go back into New North and fix the inside. I don't want no delay in that part as well, because it makes no sense if we pass the $3 million get by and we don't fix the inside. And I know as a park building school commissioner, we earmarked a budget for that to make sure we fix the inside. But I want to make sure that if the state approves it, that our money is assigned for this to be fixed. One-shot deal, get it all done.
Yes, sir.
It's not fair that our kids in the North End, by the way, I went to New North when it was New North. I was the first generation that went in. So I could tell you that there was a lot of issues going in the beginning that were never addressed and still not addressed. We're still fighting the old problems, and now we got new problems. So if we don't fix this now, shame on us.
Yes, sir.
So I ask to support. I'm glad that we see everybody here supporting this bill. So let's get it done. Thank you very much for letting me speak out.
Okay. Thank you, everyone, for your comments. Seeing no further comments or questions from the council. All those in favor of passing the resolve, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Ayes have it. Resolve passes. Okay, Mr.
I just want to say thank you. I appreciate
appreciate everything.
Thank you, folks.
Thank you so much. It means a lot to my community.
Thank you.
And to the city of Springfield.
Thank you, Councilor Gomez.
Nice job.
Okay, do we have any reports of committee this evening? Councilor Gomez.
Councilor Gomez, Health and Human Services. Last Tuesday at 4 o'clock, we had a Health and Human Services meeting. I was joined by President Michael Fenton, yourself, Councilor Justin Hurst, Councilors Orlando Ramos, Councilor Collins, and my committee members, Councilor Marcus Williams, and also Councilor Melvin Edwards. We were also joined by Commissioner Helen Colton. We had our law department, Attorney Alicia Davies. We also had our solicitor, Ed Pakula, and we also had a Hammond Care Facility with the attorney and also some of the owners there at the meeting. Our meeting kind of went longer than we assumed it would go. There's a lot of questions still that haven't been answered. Councilor Melvin Edwards motioned to keep the matter in committee, and it was seconded by Marcus Williams. So I'm proposing that we have our next meeting so we can probably hopefully resolve the matter by the first weekend of August. But now the matter has stayed in Health and Human Services Subcommittee.
Okay. All those in favor of receiving the report of committee, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Any other reports of committee this evening? Councilor Bud Williams?
Yes, Mr. President. I think on the agenda there's a reappointment for the Springfield Housing Authority.
I thought we were supposed to look at it.
No. Oh. If you want to sign it anyway.
Springfield Housing Authority. Miss Angela Robles.
I thought we were just supposed to look at it.
Is it on the agenda, Anthony?
Okay. Yes, is Angela here?
No, Angela had a conflict. The Housing Authority had their outing this afternoon. She called me last week in advance. She did send a resume. She did send a letter. This is, and I asked the council's indulgence because this is a reappointment. It's not a new appointment.
Okay.
She's been serving there since 2012 to present. And part of her resume, she did talk about what she does as a board of commissioners. Determines the mission and purpose of the organization, hire, direct, and evaluate the executive director, ensure effective organizational planning, convene monthly board meetings, evaluate and act on recommendations made in the director's report, ensure adequate organizational resources, approve administrative program and project budgets, manage resources effectively and review financial and audit reports, adopt, review, and revise Section 8 administrative plan, personnel policies, and associated matters, review proposals for new or change to existing housing programs or projects, review legal matters and respond to difficult and sensitive employee, client, and citizen complaints, and review authority staff decisions on such matters. And she currently works in the district attorney's office. No, she was in DA's office from 2000 to 2003. And currently, I think she works for Massachusetts Department of Children and Family Services.
Okay, great.
So with that being said, it's a reappointment. I did speak with her, just asking the council to just reappoint her to the Springfield Housing Authority.
Okay, all those in favor of accepting the report of committee, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Okay, all those in favor of suspension of rules to hear item number 28, the appointment of Angela Robles, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Okay. Mr. Clerk, item number 28. I want to thank the clerk and Councilor Williams for getting this one on the agenda. The last couple appointments that we had, there was some confusion about how to handle it. Very appreciative. Everybody appreciates the notice here.
Item number 28 is the confirmation for the appointment of Angela Robles to the Springfield Housing Authority.
Okay, roll call, please, Mr. Clerk.
28. Councilor Hurst, absent. Councilor Shea.
Yes.
Yes, Councilor Twiggs.
Yes.
Yes, Councilor Allen.
Yes.
Yes, Councilor Rook.
Yes.
Yes, Councilor Bud Williams.
Yes.
Yes, Councilor Ramos.
Yes.
Yes, Councilor Marcus Williams.
Yes.
Yes, Councilor Gomez. Absent. Councilor Ash.
Yes.
Yes, Councilor Edwards.
Yes.
Yes, Councilor Walsh.
Yes.
Yes, Councilor Fenton.
Yes, more than sufficient. Appointment is confirmed. Any other reports of committee this evening? Councilor Ramos.
Thank you, Mr. President. The Economic Development Subcommittee met on the 16th of June. Myself and Councilor Gomez were present. There was one item on the agenda, and it was the discussion of the order to approve an application to submit to HUD for the authorization of the downtown dining district. Brian Connors made a presentation on behalf of the Economic Development Department, and it's pretty straightforward. And I just want to say this: it's a great idea, and a wonderful opportunity for the city of Springfield. A lot of us, at one point or another, have expressed our interest and our support to revitalize the downtown area and make it a more family-friendly atmosphere. And this is intended to do just that. The intent is to attract new restaurants to the downtown area, to create this district where established restaurants will be able to borrow funds from the city and pay back at a very low interest over the terms of 5, 10, or 20-year terms. It is anticipated that the city, through this program, will offer a minimum of 7 loans with a maximum loan of $200,000. And this is intended to attract new established restaurants, and so restaurants that are already established in other communities that want to expand. But it isn't just limited to them. There will also be funds available to restaurants that are existing in the downtown area for expansion. And so this is a great opportunity for the city of Springfield to revitalize the downtown area. We did not take a vote in committee, but I do want to express my support. I think this is a win for the city. And so I want to make a motion to take that item out of order at the appropriate time, Mr. President.
Okay. All those in favor of receiving the report of committee, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Any objections to hearing item number 17? Okay, Mr. Clerk.
Item number 17 is an order approving the application to submit to HUD for the authorization of the Downtown Dining District Fund, sponsored by the mayor.
Good evening, Mr. Connors.
Good evening. Brian Connors from the Economic Development Office, 274 Springfield Street.
Thank you.
In Springfield. I think Councilor Ramos did an excellent job in summarizing the program, but basically what this order does is allows the city to apply to HUD to access Section 108 loan funding. Section 108 program is for economic development job creating purposes. So we would be applying for $1.5 million to create a low interest loan fund to attract new restaurants into our downtown TDI, Transformative Development Initiative District, which is basically sort of the Stern Square area, if you think of it that way, from Union Station to basically Bridge and Main to Chestnut. So the whole idea of TDI, which is a mass development program, which we are one of the 10 communities that are part of that, the initial group, the whole idea of TDI is kind of focusing your efforts on a few blocks and trying to make a significant impact. But we think this program, if it works, and we think it will, we've already heard some interest from potential restaurants, we think this is a program that we can replicate throughout the city. With that, I can take any questions.
Okay. Seeing none, Mr. Clerk, roll call.
On approving the order, Councillor Hurst, absent. Councillor Shea.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Twiggs.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Allen.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Rook.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Bud Williams.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Ramos.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Marcus Williams.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Gomez.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Ash.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Edwards.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Walsh.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Fenn.
Yes. More than sufficient. Order is approved. Any other reports of committee this evening? Okay, Mr. Clerk, if we could please have item number 1.
Item number 1 is a report of the Board of Public Works to approve the installation of a 4-inch PVC conduit in James Street. The petition is by Comcast.
Good evening.
Hello, Matthew Sokop, City Engineer. This is a petition by Comcast to install a conduit in James Street. Plans and information are available if anyone's interested.
Any questions from the council?
No, tear up streets. I ask people to go and look at these streets. Is this in the street or the sidewalk or?
It's in the street under the pavement.
Okay. And when they put it back, They're just going to tar it, or they're going to put it back the way that they took it up?
They'll have to do a patch, a permanent patch over the trench.
Mr. President, you know, we spend thousands and thousands of dollars on sidewalks and our roadways, and then when these utility companies, they come in, they tear them up, and when they repatch them, it looks terrible. You get on the corner of Eastern Avenue now, walk right down Eastern Avenue, brand new sidewalk the city just did a few years ago. They patched it right in the middle. I'm not saying you, I don't know who it was. But we have to figure, didn't we do a moratorium or something? What was that on the?
That is item number 25.
Will that have anything to do with this?
It will. That is the proposal from the administration to pass an ordinance that would limit the ability of a company to cut in a road that's been newly paved.
Okay.
So I don't know how recently this street was paved, but it would apply to all pavings that take place within that moratorium period.
So if we pass this now, and then we pass the moratorium later, he gets under the radar screen, so to speak?
Well, maybe the engineer can tell us how long ago James Street was paved.
I don't have that information off the top of my head, but it wouldn't apply until the street was paved, so it hasn't been paved in the last 3 years. And it would be moving forward from this point, the moratorium would start.
The first councilman from Ward 3, has that street been paved, to your knowledge, James Street?
I don't believe it's been paved in a decade.
Yeah, in a decade. It's a one-way that goes up with that.
You need to put that on the list. He said a decade.
And part of our coordination efforts with the utilities is to have them go in and do this work. And then we would follow up with our paving program.
I mean, that's a huge problem. If you ride through the city, you look at this stuff, it looks terrible.
Mm-hmm.
Brand new street down the middle, just paved. It's just.
And if I could comment on Eastern Avenue, that was a temporary patch that they put into that sidewalk, and the utility will be going back and replacing the sidewalk with new
sidewalk. I hope so. That sidewalk is less than 5 years old. Less than 5 years old. And I told Councilor Hurst to get on there, and he walked down and he saw it. And it's really.
Okay. Councilor Ramos.
Mr. President, I have a quick question for Chairman of Maintenance and Development. I just wonder if I know that we recently had a meeting in regards to the water main break that happened in Main Street. And I just wonder if Comcast was a part of that conversation. Have we had any contact with Comcast in regards to the street conditions and repairs to the streets? Or was that exclusively Bay State? Columbia Gas, the conversation with, or water and sewer.
No, it's everybody.
Our forum was mostly utilities. The forum in June was utilities.
I wonder if there's if it makes sense to send this matter to committee and have that conversation with Comcast. There have been some streets in my neighborhood, in my ward, that have been repaired very, very poorly. By Comcast, and I just wonder who's having that conversation with them in regards to what we expect and what is required in terms of paving and repaving once they complete their work. I just wonder if we can have that conversation in committee.
Mr. Clerk, who is the petitioner here? Is it Comcast?
That is correct.
So the city engineer, what is the purpose of this installation? Is it to serve a residence or a business?
It's for the Comcast, giving Comcast permission to install the utility in the public right of way.
But we don't know to what end. Is it for a particular house where they're adding service or something to that effect?
I don't know those details. It could be for just services along that street or just an extension of their existing service.
Okay. Councilor Ramos, is that a motion to committee?
I'll make a motion to committee. I think it's important that we have that conversation with Comcast.
Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Okay, motion made by Councilor Ramos, seconded by Councilor Williams. Councilor Edwards.
I believe you have an item coming up about the moratorium, which I'll be supporting. My only concern with this, especially at this juncture of delaying this and sending that to a committee for a question, is that the residents who may be, because you don't know whether this delay and is this for services. If I'm a resident of James Street, in fact, I was born around the corner, and that was the first resident of conscience for me, was on 19 James Street. It hasn't been given much services over for more than at least a decade, so I don't think the paving is an issue. Your concerns are very legitimate to be asked, but is a delay in sending this to a committee meeting that might not get back until time in August going to delay or affect services for people in that general area? I have satellite Just switching over to Comcast now, so I don't know how much cable works, but for us to delay for the purpose of a question when we have about an issue coming up later on in the agenda that will allow for us to create the moratorium, isn't the moratorium or the conversation around a moratorium, wouldn't that satisfy your concerns or to create the opportunity for the questions you have to be answered without putting an undue burden on the residents of either James Street or the surrounding area? Because we don't know if this is a, I mean, I generally don't think that they tear up the roads for no reason, install new conduits. It's probably for some type of services, but the issue of whether they fix the road afterward is legitimate, but shouldn't be tied together.
Councilor, are there, is it just residents on James
Street? James Street is, yes, there's one, it's the backside of a Springfield Redevelopment Authority apartment right. section in the first corner closest to Walnut Street. But this is entirely a residential section.
Councilor Ramos,
the city,
maybe so. It's more appropriate to refer item number 3 to committee. That's the corner of Mill Street in East Columbus. I think you'll get their attention more if you do that one.
I withdraw my motion, Mr. President.
All right, all those in favor of the petition for the outline of fiber conduit for James Street, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Okay, item number 2. Mr. Quick.
Item number 2 is a report from the Board of Public Works in favor of a petition from the mayor to change the name of Falcons Way to Bruce Landon Way.
Okay. Good evening.
Basically sums it up. We're looking to change the name now that there's a new team in town from Falcons Way to Bruce Landon Way.
I'd like to recognize that we do have an apparent fan in the audience tonight who's wearing a Springfield Kings jersey throwback. Let's recognize that gentleman for joining us this evening. Thank you very much. Okay, so any questions from the council on this street renaming for Mr. Landon?
Well deserved.
No. Very well deserved. Okay, Mr. Clerk, is roll call required here? Okay. All those in favor? Oh, Councilor Williams.
Yeah, thank you. And this is for the whole body, but I mean, Bruce Landon, thank you for what he's done, and thank the folks for saving hockey in Springfield, Frank Fitzgerald and Picnelli family who saved that franchise. And I was talking to a couple of the investors, and what they said, what they hope to do, realizing and recognizing the population shift in the city of Springfield, the city becoming browner and browner, that they want to have conversations with this body and folks involved so they can involve young people in hockey. North End, Mason Square, 16 Acres, Indian Orchard. They've talked about that privately, and we're going to have a public conversation about it so we can make sure that all kids, you know, take advantage of the hockey and the great hockey in the city of Springfield. I just wanted to say that.
Any other councilors? Okay. All those in favor of the renaming of Falcons Way to Bruce Landon Way, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Renaming is approved. Item number 3.
Item number 3 is a report from the Board of Public Works speaking in favor of the installation of a 4-inch PVC coaxial cable in Mill Street.
Councilor Ramos.
Motion to committee, Mr. President.
Second.
Okay, a motion made by Councilor Ramos, seconded by Councilor Edwards to refer this matter to the Maintenance and Development Subcommittee. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Ayes have it. Item number 3, sent to the committee.
No.
Okay. Item number 4, Mr. Clerk.
Item number 4 is the approval of a Mass Works infrastructure grant in the amount of $2,770,000 sponsored by the mayor.
Good evening, Mr. Connors.
Good evening. This action would accept $2.77 million in state funding for the Six Corners Infrastructure Improvement Project through the MassWorks Infrastructure Program. Included in your packet is a design history of the project, which the design history began back in 2010 with UMass students working with neighborhood residents and has continued through the tornado planning process and right up until last month DPW was working with Six Corners and Maple Eye Six Corners Group as recently as a few weeks ago. The need for the project was based around public safety. This intersection shows up in the top crash list for the entire region each time that list comes out through the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission. In terms of this grant process, there were 101 applicants from MassWorks this year. Less than half of them were awarded, and we have one of the largest awards in the entire state. So we're proud of that. We think this is an important project, and the state believes that as well.
Design work to date was funded through CDBGDR funding, and this grant award will fund the entire scope of infrastructure improvements. So no city funding is being used for the entire project.
Okay, councilors? Councilor Edwards?
Just mention that many of you are aware abuts Maple High Six Corners, but it also abuts Old Hill neighborhood. There was some controversy. It is complicated because they're describing this intersection or the desire to create a roundabout as opposed to what we normally think of as a rotary. And it is kind of complicated because it's something we're not generally used to. What we generally see as a rotary can be quite confusing. The engineers have assured us that this is going to be significantly more safe for pedestrian and for traffic flow through the area. And Maple High Six Corner Neighborhood Council, in fact, did have a meeting and presentation by Chris Signoli. Our council voted in support of it. I'm not sure how the other neighborhood, budding neighborhood, feels about it. But it also, that intersection also is the conduit that leads into Lower Forest Park. So generally, the Maple High Six Corner Neighborhood Council did so vote in support of it, and I will be voting in support of it as well. And hopefully, along the path of this project, they will be more informative about the concerns, particularly around how residents cross these streets through this little intersection.
Thank you. Okay. Councilor Williams?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. President. Does this include, this doesn't include the land taking, does it? What phase is this?
This would include the land taking as well.
Okay. There was a lot of controversy. I was at several meetings, and part of that was the businesses that are going to be displaced, which I hope you can move them someplace. And there was a couple of homes that are going to be displaced.
Yeah, that's the Central Street project. So that's a different, there's a taking involved with the Six Corners infrastructure program, but the ones you're talking about is Central Street. So that's a different project.
This is at Six Corners.
This is just the Six Corners intersection.
And we just put sidewalks up there maybe two or three years ago, four or five years ago.
And Walnut Street, yeah.
Just brand new sidewalks. So you're going to take the building, if I'm facing coming downtown, coming across Alden from Springfield College, going downtown, to the left there's a barbershop, there's a...
Right. That building is not impacted.
That building's not in play?
Correct.
Which building is in play?
The only property, the full property that's in play is the gas station that's not, that doesn't have the Dunkin' Donuts and all the other stuff. The
one to the, be on the left-hand side. That's in play. So the Citgo across the street, Dunkin' Donuts, is okay.
Yeah, the bigger gas station with all that stuff, that's
the pizza shop across the street.
Right, none of that's touched.
Fine. The barbershop is fine.
Yeah.
So the only ones in play, because there was some concern that the barbershop and the small stores were in play, but they're not in play.
No, they're not in play. The only thing that happens is there's some small sliver takings of property along sidewalks, but the only actual property is that other gas.
And I can support Councilman Edwards on that.
Okay. All those in favor of accepting the grant, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Item number six.
Item number six is the acceptance of a MOCA grant in the amount of $499,911.
Good evening, Commissioner.
Helen Carlson Harris, Commissioner, Division of Health and Human Services, City of Springfield, 47 Overlook Drive in Springfield. This grant is the Men of Color Health Awareness Grant. This grant currently is administered by the UMass School of Public Health. They are subcontracting with us to administer the MOCA grant. I am very proud of this grant. The MOCA men have done a wonderful job in the city of Springfield and in our community advocating for health awareness for men of color. The data shows us that advocacy is absolutely necessary. So we're very pleased about this grant funding.
Okay, thank you. All those, Councilor Marcus Williams.
Thank you, Mr. President. Just a quick question. Does this grant take into account any of the, I guess the current opioid crisis, or is it just, HIV, AIDS awareness, things of that general nature, or does it expand?
Thank you for asking that question, Councilor. Specifically, this grant will include some information around substance use and abuse. However, the major part will really deal with things where we see men of color in data. prostate cancer, different obvious issues that relate to substances, but it'll be broader than just the opioid crisis. So thank you for asking that.
Thank you.
Okay. Councillor Twiggs.
Commissioner, how much is the total grant?
This grant, the total grant is for $499,000, but that will be spread over several years. I beg your pardon?
Antonio.
I have met with Antonio on numerous occasions. He has been to my office. We have had many conversations. He's excited about the fact that the city will be the entity that will be the administrative portion of this grant. Well, he technically for the city of Springfield, he is not. We need to go through a process. So I think you're right. He has been a main advocate, and we expect that he will continue to work with the MOCA grant. But currently, because we have not accepted the grant or started a process, it technically is not a grant that is relevant. But certainly, you can vote your conscience at this point.
Okay, Mr. Clerk. So Councillor Twiggs will recuse himself. And we'll have the vote. I think there'll be more. Okay, all those in favor of approving the grant, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Any recusals? Okay, approved. Mr. Clerk, item number 7.
Item number 7 is an oral health service expansion grant in the amount of $350,000.
Oh, thank you.
Okay,
this is another exciting opportunity. I think most of you are aware that oral health particularly is a concern around the city of Springfield. This grant will allow us to hire another full-time dentist who will be able to treat the residents of the city of Springfield. We are very excited. This is the first time that we've received this expansion grant under HRSA, the Health Services Resource Administration, and so we're excited about our potential in treating residents of this city for oral health disease.
Okay. All those in favor of accepting the grant, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Item number 8.
Item number 8 is the FY17 Senior Aid Program subgrant in the amount of $345,150.
Good evening.
Janet Denny, Director of Elder Affairs for the City of Springfield on Abbey Avenue in Springfield.
Thank you.
The Mature Worker Senior Aid Program, this grant is just for 6 months. The actual funder is out for bid, the federal government's out to bid. In lieu of the election, they have given us just a 6 month contract. We should be back here in December for the next 6 months.
Okay.
This Mature program goes through Hamden and Hampshire County. We train elders 55 years and older. Yep, they call it elders. 55 years and older, and we're pretty excited. We're pretty good at this grant.
Okay, any questions from the council? All those in favor of accepting the grant, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Okay, item number 9.
Item number 9 is the Massachusetts Cultural Council grant in the amount of $200,000.
Good evening,
Molly Fogarty, Director of the Springfield City Library. This funding is from the Mass Cultural Council Facilities Grant program, and it's for repairs to the Central Library. If you have any questions.
Councilor
Walsh. Mr. President, I do have some information that I have shared with the members of the council that I think is on your desk regarding the Massachusetts Cultural Council, and another letter that I would like to see to go to Governor Baker, but I think I can bring it up after we vote on the grant. Thank you.
All those in favor of approving the grant, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it.
Thank you.
Councillor Walsh.
Thank you, Mr. President. On your desk, you should find a letter from me regarding the Massachusetts Cultural Council, and also a list of the fiscal year 2016 grants to Hampden County from the Mass Cultural Council. I don't know whether or not the members of the council are aware of the fact that the Mass Cultural Council budget has been slashed, that the funding has been reduced, and I am asking you tonight, there's a letter that I'm going to circulate to send a letter to the governor to ask him to restore the funding to the Massachusetts Cultural Council. Since that announcement was made, more than 170 legislators have signed a letter to Governor Baker asking him to restore the funding. And I think it's important for us to know what the Massachusetts Cultural Council does. And they play a very critical role in expanding access to arts and culture. They generate $1.7 billion in economic impact for Massachusetts. And just alone in the city of Springfield, our city received over $400,000 in grant. We just voted for another grant tonight. And to me, it's kind of ironic that we've learned about this cut to Mass Cultural Council, because members of the Massachusetts Cultural Committee, the commissioner, they were here in Springfield on Friday. On Friday, Future City was launched. Future City is an initiative of the Springfield Cultural District, which we now have because of the Massachusetts Cultural Council, which is an innovative way of looking at cultural assets and turning them into economic opportunities. And a lot of that would be lost. All those initiatives would be lost without funding to the Massachusetts Cultural Council. So I'm hoping that you could sign this letter that I'm sending around and ask for the funding to the Massachusetts Cultural Council to be restored. Appreciate your support.
Thank you very much.
And okay. Melvin, I think I gave
item number 10, Mr. Clark.
Thank you.
Item number 10 is the FY17 SHINE grant in the amount of $160,000.
So ironic.
Welcome back.
If you'll indulge me for just one quick minute, I wanted to thank you for mentioning my mom. I meant to say that earlier. It's wonderful to hear her voice, and she would be so proud of all of you and all of the community. So thank you for mentioning her. The SHINE grant, it's a grant mandated by the federal government that anybody 65 and older has to declare supplemental insurance. And with this grant, we are able to touch so many lives, all of Hampden County. We touched close to 13,000 last year. And we hope to do even more than that, especially with the difference in care that's happening within the state with seniors.
Okay. All those in favor of receiving the grant, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it.
Thank you.
Item number 12.
Item number 12 is the FY17 Tobacco Control Grant in the amount of $60,832.
Commissioner?
Thank you very much. This grant is our annual grant. As you know, we have a tobacco control unit in the Department of Health and Human Services. Its primary function is education and prevention, but we do the compliance checks to assure that the convenience stores are not selling tobacco products to underage participants. So this funding is for that purpose.
Okay. All those in favor of receiving the grant, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you, Commissioner. Item number 13.
Item number 13 is the FY15 Assistance to Firefighters Grant in the amount of $48,840.
Good evening, Commissioner.
Good evening, Commissioner Cohn at Springfield Fire Department.
Thank you.
Grant is a grant from the federal government for $44,000 with a match of $4,000 to replace 22 sets of protective gear for our firefighters. As we continue to do aggressive hiring, it's important that we get this grant to help us replace the gear for firefighters and to get new gear for the new firefighters coming on. As the cancer rates continue to rise in fire service, we're aggressively trying to get two sets of gear for every firefighter so that they have a clean set after a fire. I would just like to take the time to acknowledge Gary Sullivan and Erica Floyd for their work on getting these grants. Over the last year or so, the fire department's gotten over $1 million in grants. And when you consider that the federal government gives out $306 million a year to all the fire departments in the country, I think that's a pretty impressive rate. And I acknowledge that because I know it's been popular lately to take some shots at the fire department, but there's some amazing things going on with the progress with hiring, equipment, and training that I think needs to be acknowledged. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Commissioner. All those in favor of receiving the grant, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Okay, Mr. Clerk, item number 14, 15, and 16, please.
Item number 14 is an FY17 summer youth job grant in the amount of $4,000. Item 15 is the police department donation in the amount of $3,989.80. And item number 16 is an after-school weekend program youth grant in the amount of $2,064.
Okay. Okay, all those in favor of receiving the grant say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Okay, item number 18.
Item number 18 is an order to pay a bill of a prior year for the Parks and Recreations Department in the amount of $27,555.41.
Good evening, Mr. Sullivan.
Good evening, councilors. When we got this bill, we were surprised it was for the May to June period. Usually it's around $5,000, so we're going to do an internal audit to see why there was such a large increase. But in case that there is additional due, this will give us the ability to either negotiate or determine a proper payment due for that time period.
Okay. All those in favor of suspension of Rule 19, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. Roll call, Mr. Clerk.
On approving the order, Councillor Hurst, absent. Councillor Shea.
Yes.
Yes, Councillor Twiggs.
Yes.
Yes, Councillor Allen.
Yes.
Yes, Councillor Rook.
Yes.
Yes, Councillor Bud Williams.
Yes.
Yes, Councillor Ramos.
Yes.
Yes, Councillor Marcus Williams.
Yes.
Yes, Councillor Gomez.
Yes.
Yes, Councillor Ash.
Yes.
Yes, Councillor Edwards.
Yes.
Yes, Councillor Walsh.
Yes.
Yes, Councillor Fenton.
Yes, more than sufficient. Pay those bills. Item number 19.
Item number 19 is an order to accept the CPA ballot question. Okay. Sponsored by Councillor Shea.
Councillor Shea, and I do want to recognize that we have two members of the ad hoc committee, which I appointed Councillor Shea to chair, who are here with us this evening. Bob and Lydia, thank you for being here with us. They have made a recommendation, and based on that recommendation, we have this report that we'll hear from Councillor Shea. Effective tonight, I will dissolve the committee and we'll move forward with the council's will. Councillor Shea.
Yes, and I think the first thing I'd like to do, Mr. President, is recognize the members of that committee, all four of them. Libya Early is here. Shannon Rutter was on the committee. Ralph Slate and Bob McCarroll. And I just want to point out to the council that these individuals, in a short period of time, worked very hard on this. It really wasn't that easy a thing to do, to go through this legislation and to try to find the recommendation that was made, which tries to take in consideration the least impact on the public, because it will be, if they pass it, a tax on their home bills. But let me just give you a very quick overview, and then I'm going to ask Bob McCarroll to say just a few words. This is a very unique piece of legislation. And 151 towns are in the state, or I may have that number wrong, have adopted this. But it's unique legislation because it's what I call the people's legislation. It was designed by the legislature so that the individual citizens within a community have a chance to assess themselves some money, have that money put into a fund, have the state put some matching money in there, which recently has been as much as 30%, and then have the individuals, any individual in the city of Springfield or any civic association or any group of folks in town that have a project that they want to see done, can present that to the committee that's established under this act, the Community Preservation Act, and the citizens on that committee decide what the project will go forward and what the funds will be spent on. It is different than anything else that is done because normally the mayor or the city council picks a project, we set up a budget, and we establish that. Okay? But there's often little things that can be done. Maybe it's a community garden. Maybe it's a dog park. Maybe it's a skateboard park. Maybe it's a rail trail. Okay? Maybe it's the preservation of a particular piece of property. It's what the citizens pick out. Some little thing in their neighborhood that they'd like to have done. It might be something to improve housing. You could have a program that dealt with deposit the money to fund a first-time home buyer fund, okay? On where my words went. So those are the types of things that this act allows. And all that is being asked here this evening is that we give a chance to the citizens of Springfield to vote on it, okay? Not a recommendation from us that we would support it. It's simply saying, let's let the people decide. Let's get the facts out. Let's make a decision and let it go forward. What I'm going to do is I'm going to just ask Bob McCarroll, if I may, just to give a little explanation of how the process actually works, Mr. McCarroll. There's another committee that gets set up if this passes, and explain that, because I think that's an important piece, if you will, please.
Sure. I hope all the city councilors got the one-page synopsis that was put into their box today. But basically, if the voters on November the 8th approve the proposal, the next step would be the city council to enact a community preservation ordinance. That sets up the parameters that operate under state law. Under the state law, the committee, there will be a community preservation committee that will administer the local program in Springfield. By state law, one member must come from the Conservation Commission, one from the Park Commission, one from the Historical Commission, one from the Planning Board, and one from the Housing Authority. The state law also allows for City Council, if it desires, to create an additional four slots to be appointed however they want. It could be by the mayor, it could be by the city council. They can put those kinds of requirements on. So the committee that administers CPA, once it's enacted by the voters, is anywhere from 5 to 9 people. And as Councilor Shea pointed out, CPA, unlike the normal budgetary process, which is a top-down process, CPA is a bottom-up process in that anyone, whether it's a city department, a civic association, a nonprofit organization, can bring a proposal to the CPA committee. Obviously, the CPA committee will vet it to make sure that it meets all of the state requirements, and then send those projects that they favor on to you. Ultimately, no CPA money gets spent without the authorization of the city council. The other thing I would hope that you would notice on your handout sheet is the extreme modest impact that this will have, given that we have proposed the first $100,000 of value being exempt, and we are proposing an exemption for low-income families or low and moderate-income owners, seniors who are owner-occupants. On the bottom, houses that are assessed at $125,000, and that accounts for almost half of the houses in the city, would be paying $7.37 a year. So it is an extremely small program. Obviously, it goes up. But one of the things that was pointed out to us by the statewide CPA folks is property values in Springfield are very low, but we're a big city with a lot of housing. So everyone giving $7 or $14 adds up that if we were to pass this, we would be anticipating to raise about $1 million a year, which the state will to some degree match, and that it can then be spent every year on those eligible activities of open space, recreational space, historic resources, and community housing. And it can only go into projects by and large. It can't go into maintenance, it can't go into staffing, it can't go into programming. It can acquire playgrounds, it can build playgrounds, it can rehab playgrounds. It can't mow the lawn in the playgrounds, though. And as Councillor Shea pointed out, it can also, in the case of housing, support housing, which means it could help with affordable housing programs, it could help with repairs of housing. It does not necessarily mean building more housing. So if anyone has any other questions, I would be happy to attempt to answer it.
Councillor Shea, if you want to. Okay. So in order for us to proceed tonight, I have to read the ballot question. I'd make a motion that this ballot question be approved, and if it's seconded. So I have to read this out. It's ordered that the city hereby accept section 3-7, inclusive of chapter 44B of the general laws, otherwise known as the Massachusetts Community Preservation Act, by approving a surcharge on real property for the purposes permitted by said act, including the acquisition, creation, and preservation of open space, the acquisition, preservation, rehabilitation, and restoration of historic resources, the acquisition, creation, preservation, rehabilitation, and restoration of land for recreational use, the acquisition, creation, preservation, and support of community housing, the rehabilitation and restoration of such open space and community housing that is acquired or created as provided under said act, and that the amount of such surcharge on real property shall be, and this is what the committee is recommending, 1.5% of the annual real estate tax levy against the real property, commencing in fiscal year 2018, and that the city hereby accepts the following exemptions under Section 3E of said act. One, for property owned and occupied as a domicile by a person who would qualify for low-income housing or lower-moderate-income senior housing in the city or town. Two, for $100,000 of each value of taxable parcel of residential property would be exempt. And three, the first $100,000 for value of each taxable parcel of Class 3 commercial property and Class 4 industrial property as defined by Section 2A of said Chapter 59. So moved.
Okay, is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Okay, motion made by Councilor Shea, seconded by Councilor Rook. Just in terms of process, before we hear from other members of the council, this motion allows us to put this matter on the ballot in November. After it is passed, though, we then need to vote, assuming it's passed, we then need to vote on the order as a whole. The clerk has some input. Okay, so I stand corrected in terms of the order of operations. What we're gonna do is we'll ask that Councilor Shea hold his motion, withdraw it for now, until we can approve the order that's before us. And then once the order is approved, then we'll be authorized to entertain
the motion. You want this one first?
No. Just the order as it is on the agenda.
Right.
So we'll approve, assuming it is approved.
Right.
We'll vote on that. If it's approved, then we'll entertain
then we'll
your motion and look
that.
For a second.
Yeah.
Okay. So we've got the process down. Councilors. Councilor Ramos.
Mr. President, I just want to quickly thank Chairman Shea for his work on the committee and also thank the committee members, Lydia and Bob, for their hard work. And thank you, Mr. President, for putting together the great group of people that are familiar with the issue that's at stake. My question is in regards to the ballot question itself. Oftentimes, these ballot questions are very complicated. Folks don't know what they're voting for. Sometimes it seems, particularly with the state questions, it seems that you're voting yes when you intend to vote no. So I just want to make sure that the question itself is not going to be confusing for the residents.
I will tell you that there is some proposed language, but because we are the body that approves the warrants for the elections, we'll get a second look at it in September. So if the council wants to move forward with it, we can polish up the language and it'll be in final form in consultation with the law department and the election commissioner for us to approve in September.
Okay. Fair enough, thank you.
Councilor Shea.
I would point out that the language that we have here that I read came from the law department as it was a language that the statute requires. The law department also will draft a synopsis, an explanation underneath that it all has to go on the ballot. It's a lot of reading there. But this language is what we were told by the statute we had to use that I read, okay? Mm-hmm.
And the council will recall a couple of months ago, I proposed an order that allowed the election commissioner to send pamphlets, information pamphlets in advance. So we can evaluate whether or not that's an appropriate use of resources in this case. But we do now have the legal authority to do that.
Well, we certainly can ask for clarification down the road.
Sure. Okay, any councilors on the proposal? Okay, Mr. Clerk, roll call on the order, and then we'll hear Councilor Shea's motion.
On approving the order to adopt the CPA, the provisions of the Community Preservation Act, Councilor Hurst, absent. Councilor Shea?
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Twiggs?
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Allen?
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Rook?
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Bud Williams?
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Ramos?
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Marcus Williams?
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Gomez?
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Ash?
No.
No. Councilor Edwards?
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Walsh?
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Fenton?
Yes.
Yes.
More than sufficient. Order is approved. Councillor Shea has a motion for us.
And this is, again, a motion required by the law department. So this motion that I'm making is, I move that the City Council vote to place on the state ballot a referendum question to the voters to accept General Laws Chapter 44B, Section 3 through 7, known as the Community Preservation Act, which establishes a special Community Preservation Act fund that may be appropriated and spent for certain open space, historic resources, affordable housing purposes, and to approve a property tax surcharge that shall be in the amount of 1.5% of such taxes assessed annually on real property and shall be dedicated to the fund. Such surcharge to be imposed on taxes assessed for fiscal year beginning on or after July 1, 2018. For property owned and occupied as a domicile by a person who would qualify for low-income housing or low or moderate-income senior housing in the city or town. Two, for the first 100,000 value of each taxable parcel of residential property. And three, the first 100,000 for value of each taxable parcel of Class 3 commercial property and Class 4 industrial property as defined under Section 2A of said Chapter 59.
Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Okay, seconded by Councillor Rook. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? Okay, one no. The ayes have it. Motion is approved. I want to personally thank all the members of the committee, Mr. McCarroll, Mr. Slate, Ms. Rutter, Ms. Rivera Early. We have Mr. McCarroll and Ms. Rivera Early here with us this evening, and also particularly to Ken Shea for leading the effort. This is going to be a good proposal for the people of Springfield to consider. But I want to underscore the extremely complicated nature of going through this data and coming up with the proposal that they did. They made some very appropriate recommendations, particularly regarding the exemptions and the amount. And there was a big universe to decide from. So I'd like to expressly thank all of them for their service. Thank you. Okay. Mr. Clerk, item number 20.
Item number 20 is an order authorizing the Board of Assessors to abate and the collector of taxes to dissolve the betterment lien assessed against Lot 12 on Savoy Avenue.
Attorney Alt.
Good evening. My name is Melvin Altman. I'm an associate city solicitor for the Springfield Law Department. I reside at 15 Cedric Street in Springfield. What you have before you concerns property at Westside Savoy Avenue. This is a foreclosed tax title property that was sold by the city at auction free and clear of any municipal liens. In order for the new owner to have clear title, the betterment lien needs to be dissolved. The City Council had voted back in April 10th, 2000 to levy the betterment lien. So the City Council approval is now needed for the removal of the lien.
Okay, Mr. Clerk, is this roll call or? Okay. Roll call, please, Mr. Clerk.
On removing the lien, Councillor Hurst, absent. Councillor Shea, absent. Councillor Twiggs.
Present.
Yes or
yes.
No? Yes. Councillor Allen.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Rook.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Bud Williams.
Yes.
Councillor Ramos.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Marcus Williams.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Gomez.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Ash.
Yes.
Yes, Councillor Edwards.
Yes.
Yes, Councillor Walsh.
Yes.
Yes, Councillor Fenton.
Yes. More than sufficient. Order is approved. Item number 21.
Item number 21 is an order authorizing the Board of Assessors to abate and collector of taxes to dissolve the betterment lien assessed against the property on Carpenter Center or Circle Street.
This is the same situation as the previous order. This is a property at Southside Carpenter Court, and again, it was sold free and clear of any liens. In order for the owner to have clear title, we need the lien removed. We need City Council approval.
Okay. Roll call, Mr. Clerk.
On removing the lien, Councillor Hurst, absent. Councillor Shea.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Twiggs. Yes. Councillor Allen.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Rook.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Bud Williams.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Ramos.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Marcus Williams.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Gomez.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Ash.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Edwards.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Walsh.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Fenton.
Yes. More than sufficient. Order is approved.
Thank you.
Item number 22.
Item number 22 is an order granting a permanent water easement for the new senior center at Blunt Park, sponsored by the mayor.
Good evening, sir.
My name is Myron Hatchett. I'm a senior project manager with the Department of Capital Asset Construction and overseeing the construction of the new senior center. We ask that you approve this easement, which is requested by the Springfield Water and Sewer Commission, to allow us to bring a new water main to service the new building.
Okay. Mr. Clerk, roll call. Thank you, sir.
On approving the order granting the easement, Councillor Hurst absent. Councillor Shea.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Twigs.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Allen.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Rook.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Bud Williams.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Ramos.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Marcus Williams.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Gomez. Yes. Councillor Ash.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Edwards.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Walsh.
Yes.
Yes. Councillor Fenton.
Yes. More than sufficient. Order is approved. Item number 23.
Thank you, councillors.
Thank you, sir.
Item number 23 is taking second step on an ordinance to amend Chapter 49 and establish the Thomas Wasson Local Historic District.
Okay, this is second step, referral to Committee on Enrollment. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. We'll take third step at the end of the meeting. Mr. Clerk, can we take item number 25 next so that we can comply with the appropriate procedural rules?
Item number 25 is an order amending Chapter 338 of the Springfield City Ordinances. This is regarding the moratorium on street excavation. And this is for second step as well.
Okay. All those in favor of second step referral to Committee on Enrollment, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Okay, the ayes have it. Item number 24, Mr. Clerk.
Item number 24 is it's a motion to amend Chapter 110 of the Springfield City Ordinances regarding animals.
Good evening, Ms. Peebles.
Good evening. I'm Pam Peebles, Director of Animal Control for the City of Springfield. I'm here tonight to ask you to consider amending Chapter 110, the animal ordinances. I came in front of this body about 16 months ago asking for some changes after Mass General Law had done a comprehensive change to their animal control bill. And I think that with the help of the law department and animal control and your approval, we made significant differences, but in practice, we're realizing there was some small gaps there that were pretty important. So I believe you have the summary of changes in front of you, and I can go over them, or else I can just answer questions.
Okay. Any counselors? Counselors, I do have one content-driven piece. I don't know if there's support for it, but since we're at the end of a long meeting, I'd rather just say it here. Section 110-9 creates a $100 fine for interfering with the enforcement officer.
Yes.
Is there any reason why we wouldn't make that $300 the maximum allowed under law?
No, I think that's a great question. I think that we were just always looking for consideration given the struggling times, but when someone does take that step.
Yeah, if somebody's interfering with an officer of the city that's trying to conduct their business, I think that deserves more than $100. Councillor Gomez?
I do have a question with that. Does that, say if they were taking my dog and I wanted to stop them from taking my dog, does that mean that I could get fines for stopping them from taking my dog?
It's
a question.
If we are in the street and we're mm-hmm. taking control of your dog and you're there, we're going to have a conversation that would not be interfering unless the behavior escalated. Okay. So we would be talking about rabies vaccination, leash laws, and licensing. Okay. The vast majority of people are really compliant. They just need a little nudge in the right direction to understand ordinances. So that would not...
So it would be like a play-by-play situation.
I'm sorry?
What did you call them? I don't want to call him
the animal enforcement officer.
The enforcement officer. So it'd basically be on that officer to say if they were or determine that the person was hindering them from taking custody of the dog, the cat, whatever it was, right?
Right. This would be in times where we have to call Springfield Police for backup, so there would be other people involved. It would not be just us making that decision, one officer.
And then the police would enforce that ordinance, okay.
Animal control would enforce it, but we would have called for backup, so that
so
would
you
also
guys,
be documented.
You guys can write the ticket?
They
can
That's
write
correct.
The
ticket?
Yes. $300, though?
No. They can write, the $300 would be if somebody interferes with the officer. So That's different than...
Oh, man, I have a hard time doing it. I don't know. All right.
Well, if it's not the will of the council, I mean, personally, I was looking at it and I was thinking, you know, $100 isn't that much money. If somebody's interfering with the animal control officer, they need to feel safe when they're out there.
No, I completely understand that. But just even when they take the dog and it's $100, it's a lot to even get your dog back. So I think $100 is still a lot of money, $300. But I think $100 would stop them anyway. I'm just, because it's happened to friends of mine that, you know, they get their dog taken, you know, to get their dog back or their baby. There's certain things, like she said, vaccinations and stuff. They don't even want to get hit with that. So, and that's somewhere around $100. And if they have a bail, we call that a bail sometimes to get them out. You know, I think $100 would people would pay attention to that. But it's on you guys, you know, $300.
I'm not gonna just for purposes of clarity, this $300 that I'm speaking of here, this would only be for somebody who interferes with the animal enforcement officer trying to do their job in the community.
Yes, perhaps we have an order from the hearing committee that says to remove dogs on X property because they are found a nuisance or dangerous.
Yeah, I just don't want people yelling and screaming at the officer, getting in the way, and I can see that being a... Councilor Edwards.
Well, I'm in support of the ordinance as it stands, but I also very much would be in support of raising it to $300. $100 is enough to cause a ripple in my family budget on a monthly basis as well. But I sit on that committee, and these officers are when she actually, you know, when Pam started to walk up and I saw her earlier, she's one of my heroes. I had a hearing last Wednesday for a nuisance dog. I have another hearing for two more dogs this coming Wednesday, or two days from now. And I have a hearing in August for a group of dogs that have actually bit somebody. I'm having too many of these hearings. And the sad thing is when you describe them as your babies, one of the things, I just had a conversation with somebody earlier today about the fact that you wouldn't leave your baby in a room for a long period of time without supervision, but we do it with our animals. You would not let your baby not go to the pediatrician, but we're doing that without our animals. We have laws on the books on and recommendations on neutering, spraying, on the issues related to the health of your animal. The corner of my street, three houses up from my front door, is parvo, which is very contagious, and fortunately for the animals in my house, they have their shots. But every dog in my neighborhood who is not is feeling the effects of that. I live in a neighborhood that I'm very proud of my street. Very diverse, great street to live on. But unfortunately, in the area where I live, I can tell when the first of the month comes because I can see the stray dogs that the people have left who were renters, who have moved away and left the dogs. I've got a house around the corner on Dorn Street. You might remember getting a call over somebody, a vacant house where the bank has fortunately done what they're supposed to do after a long, long argument and many, many calls to get them to secure the house. But there's cats in the house now. And Animal Control, they came out and did the best they could to get the cats, but they're scared, so they're ferals and they're hiding. So they took the ones they could catch, the ones they can are still in there. So the thing is, this is a much more serious of an issue than what people realize and think about. And like I said to one of my colleagues on that commission back a couple of hearings ago, many of you obviously have, I said to them, they obviously don't spend much time in Superior Court because everybody comes in and has got a tough guy attitude until the judge makes sentence. And then it's my baby and now I'm going to cry. And I don't have a lot of sympathy for poor dog ownership. Many of you know my wife was bit 10 times by my neighbor's pit bull, and I was the owner of a pit bull at the time, so I know it's not the breed, it's the ownership of the dog. I have three rescues. I have two feral cats, they're all rescues. I very much think that this is an issue that is not being taken seriously enough in the city. These people who go out to do these things, they are taking a member of somebody's family. But the part of the problem in our society, in just my opinion, in our city generally, is that the response to bad behavior doesn't equal out to how we respond to it. And the thing is it's the animal who actually dies when they allow parvo and you don't get the things and you don't get them registered and you force these officers to come out. So to be honest with you, I support them to change to $300. I would hope that you would all do it because in some cases, they're getting cussed out. And even further than that, if it gets to a hearing, Most people in the city of Springfield don't know that if your neighbor's dog is barking for 10 minutes continuously, that's a violation of the ordinance, but it still has to be documented, and then we have to bring it in for a hearing. The neighbor who calls and complains about the neighbor's dog that's pooping in their yard, that's being barking, that's being tied to the tree, what have you, they have to put themselves out there as well, because they're the one who will be trade over back. The neighbor knows who's calling and complaining, and they're showing up in a hearing and taking time out of their day to come before us to talk about how important this is or how much of a nuisance this is. We need to take this very seriously. So out of respect for the poor people of my neighborhood, and my family is not that far from being poor, but the reality is that as long as I don't violate, as long as I don't break the rules, I don't have to worry about paying to get my dog back. And as long as I'm following the laws around getting my shots, it's not a burden to me, because before I went and got my dog, I realized that the only part of the ownership and responsibility of having a dog is being able to afford to take him to get his shots and to be able to have a leash. When you live next door to somebody who has a pit bull for 9 months, and when animal control comes with the police to take the dog, they don't even own a leash. They don't even own a leash to take the allow for animal control to take the dog away. That is something that some of us will not tolerate any longer living next to and living with. And that's unfortunately not a made up story, but that is the truth of what I live with. Thank you.
Councilor Edwards, is that a motion to go from $100 to $300?
I'll make the motion that it's the same from $100 to $300.
Is there a second to that motion? Okay, seconded by Councilor Shea. Any discussion on the motion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed?
No.
Okay, the ayes have it. The amendment is made from $100 to $300. Okay, now on first step, passage referral to Committee on Ordinances. All those in favor of the ordinance as amended, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ayes have it. First step is approved. Okay, item number 26 is in Councilor Hurst's committee, the General Government Committee. He is not here this evening, so it will remain. Back to item number 23 for third step, Mr. Clerk, to be ordained.
Item number 23 to be ordained, the ordinance to amend chapter 49 to establish the Thomas Wasson Local Historic District. Councilor Hurst absent. Councilor Shea.
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Twiggs.
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Allen.
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Rook.
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Bud Williams.
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Ramos.
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Marcus Williams.
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Gomez.
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Ash. No. Councilor Edwards.
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Walsh.
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Fenton.
Yes. More than sufficient. Local Historic District is approved. Item number 25, third step to be ordained.
Item number 25, to be ordained, an order amending chapter 338 of the Springfield City Ordinances, establishing the moratorium on street excavation. Councilor Hurst absent. Councilor Shea.
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Twiggs.
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Allen.
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Rook.
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Bud Williams.
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Ramos.
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Marcus Williams.
Yes.
Yes. Councilor Gomez.
Yes.
Yes, Councilor Ash.
Yes.
Yes, Councilor Edwards.
Yes.
Yes, Councilor Walsh.
Yes.
Yes, Councilor Fenton.
Yes, more than sufficient. Ordinance is adopted. Any other business, Mr. Clerk?
I have no further business before this body.
Okay, this body will stand adjourned. Councilor Shea. No, I'll just, I can just dissolve it. We didn't vote to approve it, so I can just dissolve it. This body will stand adjourned until we have about a month off, ladies and gentlemen. That's Monday, August 15th, 7 p.m. That is a hearings meeting. Because we have about a month delay, if there are any regular business items that need to be placed on that agenda, I will do so in suspension of rules. After that, we don't have another meeting until... September 12th. Councilor Ramos, you will be presiding at that meeting. I will be away, very, very far away. I'll be in a room. It's the summer.